अंदर कर दो उनको। ओके
मैम पैनलिस्ट अपने आप एडमिट हो जाते हैं, पार्टिसिपेंट्स को मैंने अलाउ कर दिया।
ओके राइट।
यस मैम। पूर्णिमा मैम डन।
So call the panelists in.
यस मैम दे आर ज्वाइनिंग इट। प्रवीण कुमार सर ज्वाइन, अनु मैम ज्वाइन।
ओके आई एम शेयरिंग स्क्रीन।
मैम जस्ट अ मिनट, द चेयरपर्सन हैज येट टू वीडियो एंड ऑडियो। आई एम नॉट येट लाइव ऑन फेसबुक, आई एम जस्ट होल्डिंग ऑन फॉर नीलिमा मैम।
नीलिमा फोकस प्लीज, द कैमरा इज नॉट फोकसिंग ऑन योर फेस प्रॉपरली।
प्लीज सी, कैन यू चेक
ब्रिंग इट लोअर, ब्रिंग द एंगल लोअर। या
Am I visible now?
Yes, yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Keep this side again.
So, Bhavna, Smita, Smita, are you there?
Here, ma'am.
Come. Smita. Smita, please.
One minute to go. Ma'am, please start sharing your screen. I will tell you when to play. Just give me a second, ma'am. We are going live.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am, you are good to go.
Welcome back, dear friends. That was Shulini University saying a big hello to you. greeting you, welcoming you back to this session of the seminar. This is the fifth day. Actually, it is the sixth day because we started on Friday last week, and then it was Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and now Friday. Yesterday, we had a session that was totally devoted to Virginia Woolf. And today, we will continue from Virginia Woolf, but we will go on to more feminist literary theory. We will go on to Simone de Beauvoir. In the panel today, we have a very eminent, a very pleasant lady who's chairing the session. And whenever I see her, I'm reminded of these lines. Nilima, listen to this.
Yes, ma'am.
This is from She Walks in Beauty by Lord Byron. She walks in beauty like the night of starry skies, of cloudless climes and starry skies, and all that's best of dark and bright meet in her aspect and her eyes. There's more to go. One shade the more, one ray the less, hath half impaired that nameless grace which waves in every raven tress, which waves in every raven tress, or softly lightens over her face. Where thoughts serenely, sweetly express how pure, how dear their dwelling place. So whenever I see Nilima Kaur, Professor Nilima Kaur from HPU Shimla, I'm always reminded of these lines. And you deserve every word of what I have just uttered. Welcome, Nilima, and thank you for joining us. And we also have our faculty members here to welcome you. We have Lata Negi. Hi, Lata. Lata, good to see you.
Hello, everyone. We welcome you all on the first day of International Seminar. I welcome you.
And we have Purnima Bali, who will be talking to you once again. Purnima, hi, Purnima.
Hello, ma'am. Thank you so much. So today, yes, it's truly an honor for me to introduce the chairperson of the session, Professor Nilima Kaur.
Let's go around with the other participants and then you do a detailed introduction.
Yeah? Right.
Okay, we have Bhavna Shrey. Hi, Bhavna. Good to see you here.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And good afternoon to all of you.
We have Smita, Smita Varghese. Smita Varghese is from Hyderabad. Bhavna, where are you from? Unmute yourself.
I'm from Jamia Millia Islamia. I'm pursuing my PhD currently.
And Smita is from Hyderabad. Hi, Smita. Anoop, is Anoop here? I can't see Anoop. Vibha and Anum. Vibha?
Hi. Hello, good afternoon.
Hi, Vibha. Where are you from?
We are from Aligarh Muslim University. And I've just submitted my thesis. And waiting for my defense. Let's see.
Brilliant. Gopika? Gopika Shankar. Gopika Shankar is here. Hi, Gopika. And we have Praveen Kumar. We have Praveen Kumar here.
Hello, ma'am. How did you?
Good afternoon, Praveen. Now, I'm going to request Purnima to give a detailed introduction to Professor Nilima Kaur. Purnima, over to you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So it's an honor for me today to introduce the chairperson of the session, Professor Nilima Kaur. She is a guide, motivator, friend, and a true guru. One of the best things that happened with me in this lifetime is that my doctoral degree is under her guidance. To support my statement, I know many of my friends who waited for years just to be guided by her. I do believe that I am the chosen one. Her charismatic personality makes you feel that, yes, one day I want to be like her. Ma'am, believe me, I'm trying my level best. Presently, she is the professor and director of Center for Australian and New Zealand Studies at Himachal Pradesh University, Shimla. Thank you so much, ma'am, for chairing the session today. And I don't know whether you are aware that you are very rare. Over to you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Wow. Thank you, Purnima. And with that, we go over to Nilima. Nilima, over to you. And it's all yours now.
Foremost, thank you so much, ma'am Jekka, for having me over here. It's definitely a pleasure and a privilege both. And since last few days, I have been following, and you know that, and watching the different sessions very, very carefully. And they definitely speak about how much hard work you have put in. And I'm so sure with your expertise, with your skills, with your knowledge, and above all your affection, the young team of Shulani would really, really do go far, reach far fields. And thank you so much, Purnima. You have been really, really generous. I didn't deserve that much. But thank you so much for your love and affection. And what I feel that since last few days, we have been engaging immensely with the literature, with literary texts, and we have been into the mode of a ablochana, going back to the text, not staying with the theory itself, which in a way was a very big relief. But nevertheless, we know that theory is important and we cannot do without it. And somehow I feel that it has been a part of parcel of our studying and learning literature, whether it was Sophocles or Plato or Aristotle. And then we reached to Arnold, Eliot, the Tortoise Criticism. Then we came to Freud, Bhakti, analytical approaches. And I feel that if you don't, we don't take theory as a typical technical term used in academia, it emerges from what we have already studied. And definitely in theory, we have found so many overlappings with political science, with history, with anthropology, and other subjects. But of course, there is one more fact which we all are aware of, that somehow in last few decades, theory has overpowered the literariness of literature. Yet, it makes us understand knowledge. It makes us interpret our own understanding of a text in a very, very different manner. And I hope we all know and we understand that we say text right now, we not only mean the books, but we mean any other media, social media, movies, and comic books, and so many other things. And this is what theory has done for us. And it has made us more open to the relativity of movies, the relativity of different insinuations. And yesterday's session was absolutely a brilliant session. I thoroughly enjoyed it. And as Ma'am Manju Jaitka said, that it definitely this session is an extension of what we did yesterday, Virginia Woolf. And today, most of the panelists, we know them. They have been introduced to you. And they are going to talk about on feminism, and then they're going to talk about post-colonialism. And both are kind of similar in certain ways. But before coming from, moving from Virginia Woolf to Simone de Beauvoir, I feel we also need to remember the first feminist we had been talked about. That was Mary Wollstonecraft in 1792. Who talked about the vindication of rights. And then we came to Virginia Woolf, who talked about authorship. And there was an American, Fuller, who talked about educational reforms. And of course, Simone de Beauvoir is the one who actually changed the game, where she made it important for us to understand how biology cannot be the pretext for injustice. So how she said that biology, a woman is a social construct, and we all know that we're so familiar with her quotation, a woman is not born, she is made. And then we have moved on from there to Helen Supso, we have moved on to Betty Friedan, Ellen Shaw Walter, Kate Millett, and very lately cyber feminism. I'm looking forward to that paper indeed, and who have her away in the focus. But and similarly, when we're talking about post-colonialism, we are talking about colonialism, which used to, which has actually kind of challenged everything we have had. And post-colonialism challenges the colonialisms different. But anyways, this is something very brief. And I was just wanting to ask Ma'am Manju Jaitka that since the pattern has been for 12 and a half minutes, do we continue with that or do we want
to? Yes, please. So that we have more time for discussion later on.
Later for half an hour. Yeah. And I'm fully aware that last half an hour and the time span for the Zoom. So I think we would begin with the first one, the first speaker today. And that's Bhavna Shrey. Bhavna, are you there? I think you need to unmute yourself, Bhavna.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am, I'm here.
Yes, Bhavna is from Jamia Millia Islamia, and she is working on PhD for something very interesting, interrogating feminisms. And yes, she is going to be talking about why do we need to rescue the critical canon. Bhavna, please.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm going to speak about a room of one's own. And I feel that it does pose a certain agreeable symmetry in our present time, considering we are all very quickly getting used to the liberty of having a space to confine ourselves in. So for all of us who have sat down and attempted to study literature, one point has become an underlying premise, which is that the literary canon, and I'm drawing from Harold Bloom here, has always had a queer sense of prophetic vision, which is established time and again through very close analysis of history. The critical premise that I'm going to employ is of ontology, an interesting term that Derrida made when he wrote Spectres of Marx in 1993. And I'm going to undertake a study of Room of One's Own vis-a-vis post-feminist studies that have dominated literary criticism in past few decades until quite recently. I'm going to try and highlight the lacuna that post-feminism leaves in its wake, and which interestingly were already addressed by Woolf when she wonders why no woman ever wrote in the time of Elizabeth, while every other man, it seemed, was capable of a song and sonnet, thereby questioning the very fabric of, one, how literature is produced, two, how it is propagated, and third, how it is consumed, over and all, and for whom. She brings the domain of literary criticism and places it firmly within the everyday lived body realities and experiences of ordinary women. This, I personally believe, is her extraordinary contribution to feminism as a movement, to place it within the very ordinariness, to transport it from the loftiness of philosophy, and then navigate an ideology that promises to be real in praxis. And all of us here today, we have all become complicit to a particular theoretical vacillation between, yes, we are empowered now and the glass ceiling is a mythic construct, and no, the glass ceiling is getting more concrete by the day. In Woolf, we find this caustic engagement with this endless dichotomy, and in her very own way, she remarks upon this impossibly divided being when she says a very queer composite being thus emerges. Imaginatively, she is of the highest importance. Practically, she is completely insignificant. She pervades poetry from cover to cover. She is all but absent from history. Some of the most inspired words, some of the most profound thoughts in literature do fall from her lips, but in real life, she could hardly read, could scarcely spell, and was the property of her husband. Comparing this with the post-feminism tenet, as is it by two very famous post-modernist critics, which are Angela McRobbie and Rosalind Gill, when they theorize post-feminism, and I'm quoting them, a set of ideologies, strategies, and practices that marshal liberal feminist discourse, such as, interestingly, freedom, choice, and independence, and incorporate them into a wide array of media, merchandising, and consumer participation. From being the property of husband in Woolf, in post-feminism, women can in turn not just assume agency, according to them, but navigate through a subjectivity which is apparently entirely of their own making, a subjectivity that provides them the liberty to make independent economic choices. This immediately takes us back to Woolf's demand that a woman must have money and a room of one's own if she's to write. And interestingly, how money comes before room. Even though room has become the most popular totem, it is money that she puts before she does talk about the metaphysical elements, because it establishes the ground for agency driven from economic independence, a premise explored and exploited across post-feminism criticism quite widely. But this I would like to draw your attention to is the point of contention, that the post-feminist's easy acceptance that women can exercise a subject position, their participation in the consumer culture is completely voluntary and active, is a little baffling, because one, this is nothing less than falling into the pits of generalization and treating empowerment with a category which will fit all. And two, it leaves out the issue of conditioning, or as I think I should quote Althusser at this point, interpolation. when Rosalind Gill theorizes post-feminism, she draws this double-edged connection to cultural economy. She says, in post-feminist times, to be empowered is to be a better economic subject, not necessarily a better feminist subject. Your precedence has been set. So when Woolf asks in chapter 2 of the essay, why was one sex so prosperous and other so poor? And then a little later, four lines down, she says, I have a single and simple question. Why are women poor? This makes the ontology come full circle. Because even though post-feminism acknowledges and harps repeatedly upon economic independence, it treats this luxury and privilege like a given truth, like an everyday reality of women's existence and like something that can be achieved with no great effort at all. In post-feminist media cultures, and I'm bifurcating now, for instance, one sees women writing flawlessly and making money out of their exercise. So writing is represented an appropriate form of labor and an endeavor that allows them an overt display of self-work. But writing itself is gendered. We know écriture. We know the entire line of theory that follows from there. We know chick lit, we know chick flick of contemporary times. And they all follow a particular strain, at the end of which the woman protagonist, has been comfortably ensconced in the available framework without disturbing the status quo. So post-feminism, when it claims that if women knew that femininity is a construct, then they can play with its signs, symbols, and identities from a position of power. What must be said at this point is that subjectivity or subject position does not really exist in a vacuum. The sensibility that we all develop is largely a product of interpolated consciousness. And it is quite possible that emancipation, empowerment, choice may mean absolutely different things to different women. So when post-feminism celebrates the diversity of identities available to women, for instance, one can discuss the contemporary wage gap debate, which is still very raging and still very pertinent. And it comes from the first world, where the post-feminists first started germinating and taking their roots. It surprisingly takes a detour, a theoretical, a practical detour through that. Consider this, I mean, we still need half-naked women parading in the advertisements of luxury cars, and detergent powders are still sold to women. So it denies that we do have arrived at any acceptable juncture of equality of gender, which is what the classical feminism and Woolf dreams of repeatedly, intermittently, across the body of work that they produce. Second contended point is of the charted territory of woman's body. So body as a site of critical contestation. Within post-feminist formulations, there's a clear emphasis on women being confident in who they are, what their body means and constitutes, and how they can employ it to their own advantage. You have the cult figure of Marilyn Monroe who pays tribute to this. So you have films like Gentlemen Prefer Blonde, etc., that talks about they employing their own image to their own advantages and that being a sign of empowerment. However, the ground concerns of today's world, where social media is populated with debates on body image, fat shaming, body shaming. Also, additionally, in 26 countries of the world, abortion is not permitted under any circumstance at all, stripping women of the decision that they can make about their own body. And most societies around the world still place their honor in a woman's body. Most specifically in their reproductive organs. So the frustration of not being able to exercise autonomy comes to fore rather painfully in Woolf. And we go back to 1929, where she laments that she has been denied motherhood owing to her, what the doctor called it, fragile mental state. And in a letter that she wrote to her sister, she was a voracious writer, wrote about everything under the earth, about fridge, about the second TV, about the car, everything else. She talks about, this is the only complaint I have of Leonard, that he would not let me have babies. And she writes it exactly like that. So in the context that we are discussing right now, I mean, she has this very caustic bitterness. And in the chapter 4 of this essay, then it comes back to full. She says, one only has to think of the Elizabethan tombstones, with all those children kneeling with clasped hands and their early deaths, and to see their houses with their dark cramped rooms, to realize that no woman could have written poetry. So despite the fact that post-feminism broadly encompasses a structure that harps upon the pastness of feminism, where the pastness is merely noted, as in Rosal and Gill, mourned or celebrated, as in later writers or critics, studying Wolf's writing in general, and Rumor ones in particular, exposes the limits of contemporary dominant formulations of how the woman's question is to be addressed. And the relevance of Wolf within the ambit of the very same network of criticism brings us an argument which helped me design my paper. That is the canon, and she is the canon, must be salvaged. And established complacency is a threat. So her relevance needs to be established with the very same principle which she espoused throughout her fervid pace, the one of inclusivity, the right to write one's story, even if it is insignificant, even if it seems inconsequential, and even if it is only about demanding a room, money, or right over one's body. I think I've made my point. Thank you for your time and attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Bhavna. Indeed, compelling and definitely an extension and a joyful extension, rather, of what we heard yesterday. We would have discussion after a while. And so may I please invite the next speaker. Thank you once again, Bhavna. And the next speaker is Dr. Smita. Smita, are you there?
Yeah.
Yes, I can hear you. Yes. Smita is an assistant professor, and she's also done her doctorate from JNU. And she wants to talk about Virginia Woolf again. Yes, Smita, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much. I thank the chair and all the panelists here. Can you, am I audible?
Yes.
Can you hear me? Yes?
Yes, we can.
Okay,
yes,
all right.
Very well.
Yeah. Okay, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Smita Verghese, Assistant Professor, Department of English, St. Francis College for Women, Begumpet, Hyderabad. If you were all wondering why I have indulged in such an elaborate introduction of myself, it's because that is exactly where my concerns with this text, that is A Room of One's Own by Virginia Woolf, actually starts off from. It begins from there. I haven't chosen a traditional paper to read out. I'm just going to express some concerns that I have in taking this text to the classroom. I might talk about what my interests are, but more predominantly, I would like to focus on how a student, a 21-year-old today in 2020, actually reacts to this text when they come to the classroom. That's where my actual concern launches from. It actually begins with asking, is she viable in a classroom? Okay, can I take this text to a classroom and teach her? I would also like to, before I begin, actually apologize to Bhavna, because I'm going to be going diametrically opposite to what she's been saying so far. Okay. So I will begin this journey actually by embarking on a question that we faced in yesterday's session, where someone asked as to how men and women, you know, actually react to this text. How do they react when they come to the classroom? Is it the same? Or is it different? Now, I wouldn't know this because in my college, most of our teaching staff are women. Our management is predominantly consists of all women. And my classroom is definitely all women of a very young age. So when they come to the classroom and when they see the text, they immediately reject it. There is this trend of attitude where people, my students simply reject the text immediately. Am I audible? Can you hear me?
Yes, you are. Yes, yeah. You are.
So they simply reject the text spot on. So the reason, and they will have flippant remarks like, oh my God, so a woman just needs a room to write and money. So for that, she had to write 100 pages. I mean, what's wrong with her? So you will hear flippant remarks like this to a wider range from pretty much any sorts, you know, rolling eyes and whatever, you know, non-verbal communication also being very effective in literally writing off this text. They don't want to read it. And one of the biggest reasons why they do this is because they don't want to be called a feminist. They don't want to be associated with feminism. Don't ask me what it is. I don't understand, but that's the first reaction that you meet when you take a text like this to the classroom. The other issue, of course, we have that is very large is the problem of interest. Like most of our students actually choose this as part of a three subject major. So they actually want to train either in psychology or mass communication. And for them, reading literature is like, oh, do I have to do it? What they don't understand is that most of the times to do psychology or to do political science or to do any other subject, you need to read literature. That's where I'm forever, having a bone of contention with young people today, because I say, no, if you don't read, you can't be good at psychology. You can't be good at political science. You have to read the original to know anything. So that's where I step in, I guess. But their interest level literally takes a very big backing when the minute they meet the concept that this is a feminist text. Now, to view this as a feminist text, I will not go into what interests me in this in a room of one's own. If I have time towards the end, I will do it, because if I get into it, I'm not going to get out. So I will just stick with what students, their position right now, at least for a while. So when I was looking around for information about the text and so on, I found something very interesting. I found a text called Feminisms by Arpita Mukhopadhyay. And in that, she actually quotes Virginia Woolf from her text called Three Guineas, where she says that I'm not at all comfortable with this term. I mean, Virginia Woolf actually claims that she's not at all comfortable with the term feminism. She says it's antiquated, it's outdated, it's old, and I don't like the term at all. So it's very, very interesting that as a canon, as syllabus makers today, we have put this text in a category. And that category, the minute someone meets, especially a young, student of 2020, when they meet this, then they just want to walk away and say, we don't want to have anything to do with this text. Now, there are several reasons why this could happen. I mean, there are several reasons why this could happen. I think one of the biggest issues for, students who are post 90s and currently pursuing literature is that is in the undergraduate level, is that they need a lot of information even before they come or they visit Virginia Woolf. For us, everything started with the text. It literally began like this, and then we went to we were the generation that had one channel of DD, and then we went to multiple channels, and now we are on Netflix, Prime, etc. But students today are everywhere. They have access to all media, all levels, all kinds of information. So suppose, let's say they are watching a show like Friends, which was such a big, it was a phenomenon in the 90s. So suppose, 99 in fact, in 2000 and so on. So suppose they are watching the show, then what happens to them? If they meet a Phoebe Buffay who says, 1922, just a really long time ago, and now I'm quoting her, just a really long time ago, when men used to tell women what to do a lot, and then there was suffrage, which is a good thing, but it sounds horrible. So when you literally meet something like that, even before you walk into a text which is trying to tell you that you need space in your mind, space that is not occupied by someone else's opinion, even before that, they have met an anti-opinion to what you are taking to the classroom. They have absorbed it. They don't even know that it is in their bloodstream. And then they walk into your classroom and they sit, and then there is this amazing wall of indifference which you have to literally kind of pound every day to bring down. So for me, that is where Virginia Woolf becomes such an, she's a voice that's speaking. I mean, look at that. I have dealt with colonialists, post-colonial theorists, structuralists, I don't know, deconstruct. I have done codes and tried to figure things out, decode stuff, signs, signifiers, the whole lot of it. And then I pick up Virginia Woolf and she literally steps out of the text and starts talking to me. A theoretical framework where someone is describing riverbanks and I don't know, weeping willows and lunches. I mean, food. This is just outstandingly, for me, it's a real leap back into time and also a very, very forward into time, because she's actually today, if you read her, she's questioning this whole concept we as academicians have constructed around theory. And at the same time, how to explain this to a 20, 21-year-old in your classroom, it becomes, I think, the major challenge. I don't know, there are a lot of quotations there are a lot of texts that even Virginia Woolf kind of references, especially in that chapter when she's sitting in the library and she's figuring out what different men are saying about women. And she picks up Goethe, and Goethe had a very interesting quotation, something my supervisor actually gave me. Goethe says, if we were to be made otherwise, that is the way we would have been made. So I think it's amazing to pick up Goethe, because he's the kind of chap who is telling men, women, everybody, you know, and even young people, I guess, in that sense, that if you were supposed to be different, well, that's the way you would be. But they are who they are, and therefore dealing with that is what is becoming very, very crucial for us, especially in now with a virtual classroom, and I don't know where I'm going to meet these students. It's becoming that much more of a challenge. As far as interest is concerned, I think I always go back to something that they are viewing, something that they are watching, in order to, get them interested in Virginia Woolf. But again, I will not get into that. I will just end my concerns actually with this. Perhaps the idea that a woman can walk into a classroom today is in itself a big thing, because she's allowed into that space. In addition, when she can view a text as something that she stands in opposition of without worrying about a judgment being placed on her head, that in itself is a big winner, especially where Virginia Woolf is concerned, because that is where Woolf begins from. And nearly 100 years down that curve into time, we stand at a place where a woman can pick up a text and say, man or woman, I don't think I agree with this about this text. And that is perhaps what we as teachers should really take with us as big winners, and approach the text from that standpoint. Thank you very much. And I'm open to any questions that come up.
Thank you, Sumita. We have had a very informal, colloquial kind of conversation, but it was very insightful, especially with regard to today's girls and young women. And I really wonder what we have always been debating, and even at this stage, why we shy away from the term being a feminist. We shouldn't, actually. And I was wondering why, and there is a domination of social media. And the third thing which becomes very, very important, I think, here is location. You're coming from Hyderabad, girls' locations, where they're coming from, south and east, the position of women would be very different, north would be very different. But again, location matters. But I think we could take this discussion later on. And thank you, Smita, once again. Our next panelist is Ritushri.
Ritushri has not been able to come because she is in West Bengal, and ravaged by the typhoon. So she sent her regrets.
May I then call upon Anu? Is Anu around?
Anu, yes.
Hello, Anu. How are you?
Anu, audible?
You are.
Okay. So hi, everybody.
Hi, Anu.
I am Anu. I'm a PhD scholar at Ashoka University, and today I'm going to talk about the making of a woman in Simone de Beauvoir's The Second Sex. So what I'm really trying to understand is the category of woman that Simone de Beauvoir suggests to make, and how that is so relevant in today's times. And not really seeing it from a very feministic perspective, but seeing it from a perspective that is much more open, in the sense that with the influence of gender studies and queer studies, we see a gradual and a more post-structuralist way of understanding feminism. So that would be the methodology in my reading of certain bits of Second Sex, because it's a huge book to sort of go through. So The Second Sex was published in the year 1949, as we all know, and it really contributed to sort of delineating the slogan. In a way, it inspired a lot of women who were into the second wave feminist movement, the personalist, political, and more of, and the second wave feminism, as we all know, was more about the social issues that really concern women, starting from reproductive rights, domestic violence, workplace safety, and so on. But then Beauvoir's Second Sex really, you know, sort of goes from the social to the existential. And that is what my contention is when I try to understand what is Bhuvo trying to talk about when she really sort of intervenes construct of the woman. So from the social to the discursive to the existential, she's basically questioning the construction of the self of the woman, the gendered self of the woman. So that really sort of takes me forward to sort of understanding how that contributes to, you know, the transnational, transfeminist, queer movements, the third world women's movement that are really disparate, but are also connected through multiple identities of gender, multiple experiences of gender that intersect with one another. So in an era that is really, you know, going more towards identitarian politics, and at the same time, we also see a surge of market forces playing into the making of gender codes, and how homonormativity, heteronormativity was always there, is also sort of imposed by these normative codes. So it is very important at this particular historical juncture to interrogate what it means to really be a woman, what it means to understand the gender of a woman, or the gendered woman, or the gendered self. So this is something which I have written. So in the second sex, just a minute. So in the introduction to her book, The Second Sex, Simone de Beauvoir asks, what is a woman? Beauvoir is certain that women are not simply wombs or uteruses, because in that case, they should not have been introduced to femininity. On which she questions, is this attribute secreted by the ovaries, or is it a platonic essence or a philosophic imagination? So Beauvoir suggests that if femininity defines the category woman, all females may not be woman. She says, we are exhorted to be woman, remain woman, become woman. She further tries to understand the category woman through positivist cultural representations, such as the eternal feminine or the desire in women for leadership capabilities to seek equality with men. And she finds that women desperately seek a reciprocity of powers in relation to men and define themselves in competition to them, unaware that it often leads to their objectification and negation. A woman is always pressured to insert her subjective self to secure her space of a woman as a woman. She's defined by the universal man, so the figure of the universal man comes here, not as an autonomous being, but one who is relative to him. She is the one minus the man, the subject, an object, and a stabilized other in perpetual lack, validated only by the man's desire to fulfill her in relation to her needs. So this really needs a bit of an expansion. So to expand Beauvoir's views, it is helpful to probe into the metaphysics of the relationship between man and woman to understand the complex embeddedness between sex, gender, and desire that contribute to the making of the category woman. Judith Butler, in her book, Gender Trouble, talks about how the category woman is a produce of the juridical regime of representational politics. It is both a linguistic as well as a discursive construct. It reveals a stabilized and gendered identity marker recognized by law, and also conceals and demarcates its possibilities of expansion. However, if woman marks a gendered intervention against patriarchy, is there a singular version of patriarchy? Is woman as a category validated only in relation to the masculine-feminine binary? Isn't gender a coalitional identity which lays equal claims on class, caste, race, sexuality, location, region, and so on? This takes me further to the question of gender, which constructs woman, or woman which constructs gender. Gender, we roughly understand, is socially constructed, while sex is biological. But sex, like gender, is also a given, as one cannot choose one's sex at birth. It operates as an imitation of gender rather than an exclusion of it. So since sex is also a discursive construct, the category woman, which must borrow from a universalist notion of sex, exceeds the juridical limitations of feminist identity politics. So woman then translates to not what it is, but what it becomes. It does not carry a pre-cultural or pre-discursive signifier and interrupts both male and female bodies as the Badouvisian event. So this is basically a theoretical point made by Alan Badou, rather than reducing them to legible identities. So it exposes the workings of patriarchy that has tirelessly institutionalized or heterosexualized the alignment between sex, gender, and desire. That is, if you're born male, then you need to be a man, you need to desire a woman, you need to marry a woman. That sort of an alignment is institutionalized by the heterosexual systems, such as family, marriage, kinship. We are all aware of that. Beauvoir says that one is not born a woman, but becomes one. This is a very famous line, but we need to really break this down. She highlights gender as a construction that women are culturally compelled to accept. To become a woman, one also implies gender as a variable marker that may not be reserved only to females. Beauvoir's idea that the body is a situation suggests that it is always and already sexed, so much so that sex translates to gender, thus disrupting the assumption of it being a pre-discursive anatomical fact. The body as a situation also implies that the body is not only a passive receiver of meanings, but it also constructs them for itself. It defines itself in relation to other bodies. However, Beauvoir argues that it is only the female gender that is marked, negated, and validated by the men, who are not perceived through their gender. The female gender here, if is identified as a woman, one could presume that her identity is defined by the man. But what if the woman does not identify herself in relation to a man? So when Monique Wittig says that a lesbian is not a woman, she implies that she opts out, that is, the lesbian opts out of the heteronormative structure. Ignoring the gender dynamics with the man, she says that lesbian is a human. So Butler critiques her by introducing the concept of the metaphysics of substance, in which one creates a substance for something as unsubstantial as language. So then what do we really understand with the word human? Because human cannot be an apolitical word. It has to have a representationalist political stance. But then what, you know, Butler sort of is trying to tell us through the metaphysics of substance is that the subject, the self, or the individual, Butler says, is a fictitious reality, literalized through language. So there's more than language that helps us identify ourselves or re-identify ourselves with. This linguistic assignment of binarized identities is the work of patriarchy to institutionalize a gendered hierarchy of power. So the linguistic determination of identity is a patriarchal construct. So we need to get out of this. But then how do we then understand identity? So I imagine identity as queer. So identity is always already disruptive. Identity is always already an intervention of all other identities that make it. An identity that is not universal, that is not enclosed, but always open. So I imagine identity as queer, not as a string of identity labels, but as a performance that exceeds any label of fixed identity. Queerness suggests performativity with desire, acting as a key driver in the process. Desire does not hold to labels of sexual identity. It rather disrupts any ontological certainty of identity with respect to it. Difference in identity also brings about an inadequacy in containing desire. Desire interrupts the fixity of identity, making itself universal. The idea of the universal here is not apolitical. It only represents an empty signifier waiting to be filled by a particularity or an ontologically fixed identity. So remember that this ontologically fixed identity is also only provisional and always already open. However, the particular can never overcome its limitations and complete the process of signification. The universal, therefore, retains its empty self, constantly redefining the particular through its attendant limitations. Desire, therefore, disturbs ontological obsessions of identity, always exposing its incompleteness, a rupture in the field of its signification. Alan Badiou's idea of universalism is revealed Alan Badiou's idea of universalism, which is marked by his idea on the event, implies this incompleteness as a rupture by way of which truth is revealed, such as opening of an epoch, transformation of the relations between the possible and the impossible. So this implies that particularity is not a basis of identity, and identity is always an incomplete project, an opening to an ever-present field of disputations. It does not mean a negation of identity, but it's disruption from reaching towards any kind of fixity. A disruption that is not merely linguistic, but one that acts like a bunch of sensations tied to body parts. So each part of our body, like the erogenous zones, actually disrupt what we think we are, actually disrupt our imposed identifications. So a disruption that is not merely linguistic, but one that acts like a bunch of sensations tied to body parts, which Beauvoir says man ignores. While women are constantly made aware of their ovaries and uteruses, the testicles and its secret hormones, Beauvoir says, are constantly negated and negated by men to is it only exposes patriarchy's queernesses that both are uncontainable and deeply unstable. Thank you.
Thank you, Anu. I must say before I make some observations on Anoop's paper, I wanted to tell you all that, yes, of course, he's pursuing his PhD from Ashoka University, and he has also, he had also taught in Sikkim for 3 years, and he's also currently working on a book. So thank you so much, Anoop, for your paper. It was actually rooted in theory. And of course, we all know, and as you said in your paper, we're talking about existential feminism, and then how Beauvoir talks about women taking responsibility from moving to from subject to an object. And definitely we cannot ignore body at all. And that is what you were ending your paper with, how sexuality is experienced so differently by men and women. But we have so many questions. In fact, I was thinking that you were going to talk about difference feminism. And that is how I thought, but it has been a brilliant paper. Thank you so much, Anu. Completely, completely enthralled with your presentation. Yes. Okay, we have our next speaker now. That's a combined paper by Professor Vibha Sharma and Miss Anum Fatima.
Hello, good afternoon. Hi, good afternoon.
Hi, that's Anu.
Yes, it's Anum. Professor Sharma couldn't come. Yes, she couldn't come. Actually, we have defense going on right now in the department. So she's a part of it. Yes.
From Aligarh Muslim,
University. Yes, yes, yes.
Looking forward to the fourth wave.
Yes. So, yeah. So, ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, please. Yes.
Okay. Okay. So I have titled this presentation as The Fourth Wave is Online, Analyzing the Advent of Digital Activism and Feminist Movement in India. So I have divided this presentation into two parts. In the first part would be dedicated to Kate Millett's sexual politics, which I believe has led the foundation when it comes to theorizing the Me Too movement or the slut walk or free the nipple, such movements, and the activism that takes place online. And the second part is where I will make an attempt. I will just try to touch upon what is digital feminism and how it has managed to become a substantial mode of resistance. So over the last century, when we discuss feminism, we always limit ourselves discussing the three waves. But now somehow it has, gone are the days when feminist debate was confined to ivory towers, or those who could only afford could talk about it. But nowadays we are more likely to find bloggers and columnists battling it out on Twitters. And that has, given a kind of diversity and different voices and perspective to this movement. In this paper, we have made an attempt to study the arrival of the Me Too movement in India and how such movements found its root in works of Millett or Wolf also. In fact, I will not talk about Wolf because a lot of it has already been covered. But she has also been one of the, huge influences when it comes to that. And also we'll try to identify that this fourth wave is it as radically influential as the three waves were, and how is it more than just a hashtag? So Kate Millett, when her book was published, Sexual Politics, in 1970, and the money she earned with it, she called herself shamelessly and pointlessly rich. So, and her book, which was initially a doctoral thesis, becomes, a dealing in inherent misogyny and sexual oppression, was widely accepted as normal. She critiqued the works of D.H. Lawrence and Henry Miller, who was considered to be the pioneers of writing about female sexuality. Her thesis was based on the historical analysis of literary criticism, which she bit by bit accentuate the problematic depiction of female sexuality in their works. She also talks about Freud's concept of Alice envy, which is highly contemptuous to women. And her dissertation begins with an anal rape scene, which is slightly different from how the doctoral thesis are supposed to begin. And her work is exemplary in that sense. So Millett talked about the imbalance in the domination and subordination between various sexes since time immemorial. This imbalance has led to create internal colonization where politics is referred to a power-driven or power-structured relationships that dictate the entire system. In this paper, we have tried to explore the shaping of the Me Too movement and the digital feminism based on internal colonization. Millett argues that sex as an act has political implications where the power dynamics has a major role to play. The word politics in her title suggests the relationship between the two sexes is based on power dynamics rather than on social construct. She argues these relationships historically are based beyond the simple structure of traditions and customs. This power structure can be on the grounds of intrapersonal relationships and different organizations like castes, races, classes, sexes, etc. Now, I believe that the entire Me Too movement can be a textbook example of such politics where the perpetrators were in the position of power and their victims were subordinate. These subordinate groups have inadequate redressal through existing political institutions. What goes largely unexamined, even unacknowledged, yet is institutionalized in our social order is the birthright parity where male rule females. Through this system, a most ingenious form of intercolonization takes place. Now, this is a system is very vigorous. It is any other form than any other form of segregation. It's highly stringent than class stratification. And what is more, prominent about it, it's very uniform and it is endured by a lot of people. It is accepted. Sexual dominion has muted appearance, yet as an ideology, it is most pervasive in most of the cultures, and it also provides the most fundamental concept of power. Our society, like all other historical civilizations, is patriarchal and all the agencies of power are entirely in male hands. While patriarchy as an institutional social constant has deeply penetrated all the societal institutions. In the democracies of the world, female or any other gender that did not recognize itself as male has often held no office, or if they are, it is below even token representation. If one takes patriarchal government to be the institution of half of population, which is female, is controlled by the other half, which is male. The patriarchy appear to be twofold, where males dominates female, elder males dominate younger females, and younger males dominate elder females. Women have been facing organized oppression from their male counterparts, which not only include sexual violence, but also they are denied equal opportunities based on their gender. And I'm reminded of a very recent photo that I saw, it said that we must not be worried about the thigh gap, but we must worry about the wage gap, which is such a prevalent theme. So in 2017, the world woke up to a new trend called the Me Too movement. However, it was already there on the surface. It was started by Tarana Burke. She was an African-American. And she has been talking about FGM, female genital mutilation, which is something which nobody talks about in the South African countries. And also, the movement included survivors of all types of sexual violence to speak their truths and start a conversation, start a dialogue of such atrocious acts. And now, when it came to the mainstream movement, when an American actress, a white American actress, Elisa Milano, she asked the people that who have been victims of sexual abuse to tweet hashtag MeToo. Now, this tweet by Milano was provoked by the accusations of several women against Harvey Weinstein, which becomes the most high-profile case, sought to open a conversation where all victims had a similar platform to discuss the widespread of this violence in the workplace, especially on females. Soon enough, the viral hashtag became extensively used across all social media platforms, such as Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, where victims of sexual harassment and abuse tweeted and posted, shared MeToo. Now, it arrived in India too, and it before arriving to India, it was in South Korea, Japan, in 85 countries. So the however, the movement's global uptake is arguably due, at least in part, to its broad and inclusive appeal and ability to cross lines of stratification. Although the Me Too movement discussion has focused largely on secular women's experience, it triggered the critical discussion of silent sexist and sexual violence also in religious institutions. Now, India is not immune to global phenomena of the Me Too movement, which emboldened by this rallying cry, hundreds of thousands of Facebook posts and Twitter hashtags flooded due to the feeds of the social media users. Inspired by the Shitty Media Men list, a law student, Raya Sarkar, encouraged women in Indian academia to name their sexual harassers in the form of an anonymous crowdsourced list. The fallout and rebuke were swift. Many women were local in their support, attributing to the existence of the list to the pent-up frustration, while others disregarded it, saying that it is going to, it is going to undermine the due process and efforts of decades of feminist works. Here in India, it gained mainstream highlight of the media when actress Tanushree Dutta came out with her, her story of Nana Patekar and how she was abused and how she was sexually harassed. And another important case was BJP MP, former MP MJ Akbar. And it is interesting that even after 1 month, just after a month, there were accusations on him. We saw that the Hindustan Times gives them a space in the editorial post. Now, when asked Hindustan Times that why they have chosen Akbar to write it, they say, and I quote, "We believe that allegations of that kind are different from journalistic competence of the person concerned," unquote. So the movement, whether in India or globally, gave enough evidence that sexual assaults in the society cannot be seen in isolation or isolated attacks, acts of abuse against women, but rather as a piece of a much larger framework that continually oppresses and disadvantages women. The workplace represents is primarily male-dominated and can be a key to patriarchal oppression. This is largely the result of men in positions of power taking advantage of women who cannot fight back without the threat of severe repercussions. These men are known to threaten their victims, job security, and should they choose to come forward with their stories and accusations, which results in fear and underreporting of workplace violations. The movement, whether in India or abroad, it says that the it's 2/3 of the working women face sexual harassment. The Me Too movement provides a platform for those who had been silenced to come forward in unity without the fear that they will further be silenced or just regarded as not being truthful. This statement also holds true to the impact of the movement, which has proven that women united can similar cause truly can change the framework of an issue. Therefore, what Millet was talking about in her later, careers about intercolonization, how power determines the sexual relationship, stands true in this time and era as well. Now I will talk about the second part of it, the digital activism as a new tool for resistance. For the past few years, we have witnessed increasing visibility of feminism across an array of media, celebrities such as Beyonce, Oprah. In India, unfortunately, we do not have a large number of women, especially women from the, from the industry or from powerful positions to come out and speak. But in the West, we have those examples. And at the same time, they have come out, they have become the new face of, feminism. At the same time, the resurgence of popular feminism has promoted the individualization of women and the elision of structural critique. There has also been a surge of mass feminist protests in many countries in recent years. Today's large-scale feminist mobilizing, however, is not only a reaction of particular social or political events, but also inextricably linked to a wider context of social media. Scholars have demonstrated how scale and transnational nature of this activism are enabled by the affordances of digital media. Projects like hashtag everyday sexism, hashtag free the nipple, yes all women and being raped never reported have become international viral movements, and these novel digital feminine activist spaces have provided fertile ground for the emergence of Me Too movement. Much of this discussion surrounding the Me Too movement has focused on the role of digital media as a space for voicing stories about sexual assault, stories that had previously been silenced and remained largely invisible in the mainstream news. When the Me Too campaign spread globally, women in India also used social media to make visible that they had been harassed sexually and otherwise. The campaign made evident that everyone knew but had not quite witnessed the scale of. The Me Too campaign sent vibrations to India's feminist movement in unprecedented and dramatic ways, questioning key ideas of the movement and means of mobilization. Access to social media and politicized use of Twitter and Facebook have led Swarna Jha, you know, feminists like Swarna Jha and Alka Kurian to claim that feminist movement in India were leading a new kind of social media-based fourth-wave feminism, well before the recent feminist resurgence in the US. Such movement include the Pinjara Tod and Vile Vetter that question the restrictions of women's mobility and violence in public spaces and university campuses. And I come from a university that has, you know, that has long tradition of holding women curfew till 6 p.m. Like the women are supposed to go back to their hostels till 6 p.m. So Pinjara Tod, became one of the most important student activists that took place. From a point where the digital forms one increasingly important part of the political landscape, the digital becomes the landscape itself. We have a situation where politics is contained within the digital, and the only political subject that remains legible is the digital subject. The effect and intimacy of embodied collective action is not simply diminished in its significance, but with this comes the fact that the conditions of political subjectivity in the digital is overdetermined by the logics of the digital, which are their many elements. And I would conclude by saying that Millet aimed to show how the relationship between the sexes was one of dominance and subordination. The power relationship was institutionalized. She argued that it was a form of interior colonization, a kind of oppression sturdier than any form of segregation, more rigorous than class stratification. Feminists contend that in a male supremacist world owned and controlled by men, it is no wonder that women constantly find themselves in subjugating positions. As has been shown by statistics, 99% of the world's resources are owned by men. Hence, it puts men in the privileged position of assaulting women mentally as well as sexually. The concept of power is highly charged for women. The delimiting aspects of power in its usual sense is that it has been long since associated with violence and the use of force. Power is seen not only as an act in its own interest by exploiting the powerless, including women and children. Thank you.
Thank you, Anum. Thank you so much. It was indeed absorbing, and it was very interesting to see how you linked Kate Millett with Me Too. And the fourth wave definitely is online. And if we go back to yesterday's discussion where Professor Vivek had talked about, is a virtual space agendered, or is it troublesome, or have we been able to break the glass ceiling? Yes. Are we being trolled? Are we safe? All these questions are very, very important, but I'm so happy that you have been able to experience Pinjara Tod. And yes, definitely, but one of the things with Me Too movement was that many of the women were also questioning it. And that is what it talks about, how embedded we are into that. We are conditioned so much to question our own, that why speak now after 27 years? Anyways, and definitely, but another thing one says, women, most of the women say the beauty of feminism is its ordinariness, that Virginia Woolf says, because we all have experienced our own share of Me Too moments, maybe not necessarily sexual, maybe it could be some other way, but no offense meant to the other gender, but sometimes the other gender, the men here, take ordinariness to be not very serious. Anyhow, this could be left for the debate. Thank you so much, Anu. And our next speaker is Gopika, right? Gopika, you need to unmute yourself.
Yeah. Yes, hi, ma'am. Hello, ma'am.
How are you, Gopika? Gopika is from Department of English, University of Hyderabad. And she has done her PhD from IIT Chennai. And she's going to follow the suit. She's going to talk about feminism and Bhavya.
Yeah, thank you so much, ma'am, and thank you all. And thank you, ma'am Manju and her team for organizing this wonderful online seminar during this time. It's nice to see you all here. So yeah, as ma'am said, I'm talking about Simone de Beauvoir's The Second Text. And I'm trying to connect it with digital feminisms here, like how to read this particular chapter called The Narcissist from The Second Text. And then I'm reading it as a 21st century so from the 21st century viewpoint. So I'm looking particularly at these beauty bloggers as we see on YouTube. So YouTubers who are beauty bloggers, and then trying to look at how this chapter works with this, right? So when you read this chapter, of course, there are, of course, certain kinds of confusions as to is Beauvoir actually talking to is she actually addressing those kind of issues, or is she actually even subscribing to those things that she's saying here, or is she just talking about the wider notion of women as narcissists that was prevalent in those days, right? So a little bit about the chapter first. So this is from book two, and it's the first chapter of part six called The Justifications. So here, Simone de Beauvoir actually points out how there is a kind of narcissistic trait in all women, or every woman has this kind of a trait. So right here, let me see, like if you trace back the whole concept of narcissism, we know that it emerged from Narcissus, right? So the word itself can be traced back to the Greek mythological hero Narcissus, who is obsessively obsessed with his own self, excessively obsessed with itself, his beauty and everything, and like how his own reflection actually gives rise to this kind of a feeling, and how he started disregarding others. So we can see that it didn't really emerge with women, if you look at even the etymologically. And then going back to this chapter, so here she says, if she can offer herself to her desires, that is, if women can offer themselves to their desires, it is because she has felt herself an object, right? So women feel that they are objects, even like within themselves. So they themselves have a feeling that they are not just subject, but they are kind of objectified. So first, it's the mirror that tells them that they are objects. So first, when they play with their dolls, when little girls are actually given dolls to play, they look at that particular image. They want to actually shape that kind of a body image for themselves. And then they start looking at the mirror, and then, of course, mirror or whatever, these can happen together. And then they start looking at others for this kind of an appreciation from them. So when they can't play with the dolls anymore, they want that appreciation coming from others. So it is about the others' gaze falling on themselves, and then their own gaze on themselves, right? So obviously, the Simone de Beauvoir here talks about this, the concept of narcissist as dealt by Freud here, the psychoanalytical kind of a view. And then, so that is why I want to look at how narcissism is understood today from as a pathological condition. So if you look at the narcissistic personality disorder, or NPD as it is called, so even here, so in fact, the narcissism as in the psychiatric sense, it can be traced back to Havelock Ellis and Paul Nack when they dealt with this. And in Ellis, in fact, this particular work also talks about women as obsessed with themselves, again, not being attracted to others. But this work also actually looks at other concepts like national narcissism, then patriotism, excessive love for one's own land. So it is not limited to just human beings alone, but again, coming to, how other kind of conditions, or rather not just towards one's body. But here, when De Beauvoir is talking about narcissism, again, connecting it with the Freudian idea, which Freud's work, Narcissism and Introduction, which he published in 1940, so that particular psychoanalytical point of view, it's just about the body or the beauty, and beauty as skin deep. That is the kind of idea that you get here, right? So only when women are obsessed with their body. But if you look at narcissism as a psychological condition, we know that it's not just limited to one image of the body, but it could be about the self, one's obsession with the career. So if somebody's holding a particular kind of a position, they can become excessively manipulative, controlling of others. So even in narcissistic personality disorder is found in mothers, and found in fathers, found in siblings. So all these things have been talked about. So, but this particular chapter limits itself chiefly to women and their body. But that could be because with Simone de Beauvoir, obviously wanted women to get out of that kind of a framework and then come out and actually fend for themselves, and then work and then earn money, right? So that could be the reason. So that is why I'm looking at this idea of beauty bloggers, because here she says that when one particular thing that she borrows, and she says, I was less vain of my intellectual gifts, which were too vigorous to be doubted, than of the image reflected in my oft-used mirror. Physical pleasure alone fully contents the soul. So here, of course, the idea of physical pleasure is a little questionable here, but this is Madame Dan Knowles, as she talked about during that time. So that is the thing that De Beauvoir is talking about here. So this idea of physical pleasure, but if you look at even like some of the new movements, like how body also needs to be talked about, not just in a feminist sense or even in the queer theory, but even in an aesthetic sense. So the somaesthetic, or the kind of movement which is trying to bring about this aesthetic understanding of the body here, right? So now from here, when I move towards this beauty bloggers, so I look at particular ideas from this chapter and then connect it with them, with this kind of blogging, right? So here, let's say the beauty bloggers, they talk about so many things that they have a particular kind of format, from organic kind of facial or something that they talk about, to underarm waxing, or it could be even about choosing the right kind of innerwear. They talk about menstrual cups. So all those things are actually talked about. So it's not any more limited to just one or two ideas here. And then there is this, of course, like superficial things like what's in my bag, or celebrity inspired looks. And then things like no makeup look, recreating my wedding day. So these are some of the things that they follow. But apart from this, what you can find is they also present their day in my life videos, where they talk, like, show their cooking and cleaning things. So here in the chapter, you can see one particular idea. She's occupied, but she does nothing. So this is quoting from Simone Weber. She's occupied, but she does nothing. She does not get recognition as an individual through her functioning as wife, mother, housekeeper. So when I look at these beauty bloggers, and when they show their cooking and cleaning videos, or their day in my life, whatever, again, how they engage with their husbands and children. So my question is, are they doing it because they want the larger appreciation of the world? Or is it because, they're just showing it like, this is how my life is. Just because I'm a beauty blogger doesn't mean that I'm not doing other things, right? So there was even one question to some blogger, like, your face is like all done well, but then your hands don't have that kind of thing. You haven't really manicured your hands. And she says, yeah, I have so much to do at home, so I can't keep my hand manicured all the time because I'm busy with other things. I have to take care of my kids. I have to take care of the kitchen. I have to do the cleaning. So they are actually admitting that they do other things. And again, if you look at some of the videos by people like even Alia Bhatt or Sonam Kapoor shows her no makeup look, and then Alia Bhatt shows the cooking videos. So we see that they're also trying to. So this is like trying to be part of the crowd here. And again, that question of feminism, that radical feminism, like portraying with Smita, which actually talking about like her students, how they shun this the very notion of being a feminist. But that is something that I find in many of the people today, because if you identify yourself as a feminist, you may not get so much of support. So obviously these bloggers, only if they get views, if they get the right kind of comments, they can actually continue to be, right? So that could be one reason, but which I'll come to that a little later. So then there's another idea that is said, that is the narcissist, again quoting from the book. The narcissist finds it impossible to admit that others are not passionately interested in her if she has manifest proof that she's not adored. She imagines at once that she's hated, right? So then she starts feeling that she's getting persecuted and things like that, right? So this whole idea of being hated if you're not really admired. So when you have these hate comments on the social media platform, when people remove, delete negative comments, so they are often said, there is often this debate coming up. Are these people actually obsessed with themselves? Can't they take even one negative comment? But what they say is, what these people who actually put these videos, the video makers, what they say is, it's because the negative comments, again, start a whole trail of negativity there. And sometimes it could be a kind of psychological manipulation of viewers or even by the viewers to actually bring their rating down. So again, that can lead to a lot of other issues, which is why they are doing. They keep on deleting some of these comments. And if you look at how it happens with even men, for instance, when there is a like this acid attack, so those kind of cases, if you look at it, don't they also actually take out on their, the victims? Then again, there is a victimization of the victim there, right? So actually, for instance, if a girl actually rejects a proposal and this kind of acid attack, or sharing unacceptable images or videos and spreading negative kind of a picture of them. So we can see that it's not just women who can't take in this kind of negativity, but men do behave that way, right? So it is not, again, so why are women being cornered there? So that is my question here, right? So why should women alone be? So it's not just about women, even men do have that kind of a trait, but they show it in a different way, right? So that is the only difference. Then there is another idea that is mentioned in the book. Men's fortunes went to pay for the gold, incense, and milk that Isidora Duncan or Cecil Sorel heaped up around their thrones. So, right, so how men used to pamper these women and how they had to pay for all the beauty, whatever pursuits they were getting into, right? So that is one thing, one idea that is presented. But of course, how these men got their fortunes, that itself is questionable, but that is a different topic altogether. But if we look at these beauty bloggers, again, there will be this question, from where do they get their products? How do they buy them? So some of them have said when they started blogging, they used to actually buy it. They didn't depend on anyone else. They didn't depend on their parents or their husbands. They started, and once they get into it, of course, there is a market coming into play there, and they get all these sponsored products, and it's something like the in-house marketing that happens there, right? So obviously, the marketing trends to go on here. So it is a combination in a way. So we can't say it's just this love for this kind of a thing, but we are not definitely wasting anybody's money here. Then, so it towards this, and not really in this chapter, but in the concluding chapter, and in the conclusion, Simone de Beauvoir says, if the little girl were brought up from the first with the same demands and rewards, the same severity and the same freedom as her brothers, taking part in the same studies, the same games, promised the same future, and I skip a little, and again I continue, the little girl would not seek sterile compensation in narcissism and dreaming. She would not take her fare for granted. She would be interested in what she was doing. She would throw herself without reserve into undertaking. So obviously here, Simone de Beauvoir saying that away, like out of this kind of a beauty pursuit and things like that, she will get into more of economic kind of pursuit where she'll become independent, and women will also have a voice for themselves, right? So that idea is presented here. So if you actually look at many of these bloggers, why do they get into this kind of a thing? Why can't they talk about, for instance, women's movement? Why can't they talk about books, right? So those kind of questions are there. But these kind of videos get better shares, better likes, whatever, better views, and obviously they get better money. So they are becoming economically independent. Obviously, cooking videos rank a lot, especially during these times. We can see that many hit 1 million and 2 million views. So accordingly, they get paid, right? And there, some of these bloggers have said that, you know, when they are presenting, when they're doing something like this, they are obviously in an empowered state. It's not that they are completely disempowered or anything. They are empowered to at least come into the public there. Maybe they have other issues, but within themselves, of course, there are certain senses, there is a certain sense of insecurity. For instance, one blogger, she says she was actually trained to be a nurse, but she couldn't take up that profession. So she started making blogs. Then there is another one again, a nurse, she says that, you know, she was excessively really unhappy with her skin tone, and she actually did something to get fairer. So you do find this kind of thing within them, which is why they are presenting themselves. Now, if we look at this idea, it's not just women, but even men also take up a lot to grooming these days, right? So men, women, or anybody, even like people, whether from transgender community, because the whole idea of grooming has got so much of importance today in the kind of corporate world. Right. So when I look at this, what I find is this whole thing is like, it's not a radical kind of feminism, but the kind of thing what you call the girly culture or the girly feminism that they are showing, which came as part of somewhere near the third wave feminism. Right. So a little bit I'll read on that. Girly power or girly culture is a central yet contested strand within the third wave. Its proponents argue, so this is from R.C. Snyder. And its proponents argue that our desires aren't simply booby traps or set by patriarchy. Girly encompasses the taboo symbols of women's feminine enculturation. So the third wave desire for girl power seems simultaneously authentic, playful, and part of the younger generation's project of reclamation, which also redeploys terms like bitch, cunt, and slut. Once again, a little bit from here. So it is not just about this feminine, this kind of thing, but it's also about like the Barbie dolls, makeup, then fashion magazines, high heels, and face things it isn't shorthand for we've been duped. So using makeup isn't a sign of our sway to the marketplace and male gaze. It can be sexy, campy, ironic, or simply decorating ourselves within the loaded issue. Right, so here this idea of narcissism does come into play a little bit. What Simone de Beauvoir says, this whole thing about decorating themselves, right? But this, even when they say that we are not swayed by the marketplace, obviously, the market too has something to say. So that is how I see this whole thing. Of course, this needs to be talked quite a bit, a lot, but I think I may be running out of time. So I think I'll just wind up with that here. All right. So is that okay, ma'am? Yeah.
Yes, absolutely fine. Thank you, Rupika. It definitely was an interesting presentation, especially regarding the beauty bloggers. And it was in contrast to Anup. Paper, who concentrated on the complete book, and you thought you would do a more closer reading. So definitely interesting. And yes, we cannot ignore the physical self. Most of women of color live through body, live through skin. That's a harsh reality. Yeah. And no matter how condescending attitude we may develop towards beauty bloggers, coming from our intellectual stance, if we want to do that. But definitely it is about empowerment, and it is definitely about economic independence, which takes us again to Virginia Woolf, that how economic independence is so essential. Yes, and you have such a valid point about beauty and narcissism and good looks and grooming, where men and women are in a liminal space. We all want to look good. So anyways, thank you so much.
Thank you
for your paper.
Thank you all.
Now we have the last but not the least. We have a paper by Dr. Praveen Kumar, and if I may take the liberty, who has been a friend and who is a retired principal and still keeps on writing, going for conferences and talking otherwise also. So much of he has such interesting things to talk about, and his today's paper concerns with the Orientalism, the text which is supposed to be as important as interpretation of dreams by Freud, and with Origin of Species, it is almost on that platform, and it talks about, it came around Derrida and Foucault, and which talks about non-European perceptions by the Europeans and how Orientals had been constructed by the Europeans. But he wants to talk about the COVID-19, and that in this webinar, in this virtual world, we suddenly land on to a harsh reality which we are living in. This is such strange quarantine times. Welcome, Professor Praveen. We're looking forward to your paper. Please.
Good afternoon, friends. Good afternoon, Neelima. And I would like to thank Professor Jetka for suggesting me certain topics, and I've chosen one of them. And I'm going to speak on Orientalism, possibilities of change in perception in the post-COVID world. And I'll begin by quoting Rudyard Kipling's words, "Go east is east and west is west, and never the twain shall meet." They are a good pointer to the concept of Orientalism. In my paper, I intend to first explain the broad framework of Orientalism and then indulge in some wishful thinking that in the post-COVID world, some of the pernicious perceptions of the East, which Orientalism has perpetuated so blatantly, getting demolished. Edward Said's book, Orientalism, published in 1978, is arguably a seminal text that offered theoretical framework for post-colonial theory. He drew inspiration from a wide range of scholars, but Michel Foucault's notion of discourse and Gramsci's idea of cultural hegemony occupy a central place in his critique of Orientalism and its implications for East-West binary. Said has used the term in his work in three different ways, but they are not mutually exclusive. They are instead interdependent. The first is, as an academic designation, where it simply refers to Oriental studies as a discipline. Specialists, however, don't prefer to use this, the term in the sense, because too vague and general, and also because it appears high-handed executive attitude of 19th and early 20th century European colonialism. And the second way in which he uses the term is with reference to the style of thought, based on ontological and epistemological distinction made between the Orient and the Occident. Treading this line of thought, many writers, philosophers, political theorists, economists, and imperial administrators accepted the basic distinction between East and West at the starting point for elaborate theories, economic policies, literary writings, and political discourse related to the Orient, its people, and their destinies. As something more historically and materially defined than the previous two ways of understanding Orientalism, this is the third way in which he uses the term. Taking late 18th century as a rough starting point, Orientalism can be discussed and analyzed as the corporate institution for dealing with the Orient, dealing with it by making statements about it, authorizing views of it, in a way restructuring the power relation. To identify Orientalism, he employs Foucault's notion of a discourse as described by him in The Archaeology of Knowledge. he feels that without examining it as a discourse, one cannot understand the enormously systematic discipline by which European culture was able to conceptualize the Orient politically, sociologically, ideologically, and so on. In this third sense, the idea of Orientalism is a tool with which the real Orient, as it really exists, as opposed to what the Western eye perceives, the real Orient is appropriated by the West in a bid to dominate. A process of de-wording and then re-wording of the Orient is undertaken by overemphasizing stereotypical images and conceptions. Orientalism thus operates almost like an archive or a corpus of information which the colonialists have assiduously built up over a period of time. From this repository of stereotypes, the genealogy, existence, and identity of the Orientals originate. The West appropriates for itself a preeminent position, as the East is discursively produced as the West's inferior other. In fact, Orientalism is not an empty abstraction. It's a cultural, economic, and political fact which cannot be simply wished away. In this self-styled binary, East is viewed as voiceless, sensual, despotic, irrational, exotic, superstitious, lazy, corrupt, and gullible, while the West is hailed as democratic, rational, progressive, truthful, dynamic, and so on. Tennyson's following lines from Locksley Hall will put things in perspective. And actually, the background to this poem is that the speaker in the poem, he loved his cousin, but the cousin didn't reciprocate his love. And that's why, out of frustration, he makes this statement. I'll take some savage woman. She shall rear my dusky race. But I count the gray barbarian lower than the Christian child. So the words are so powerful and so much negative for the East that one can just imagine what kind of conception people had about the people from the East. This binary of superior, inferior, civilized, savage is not restricted to any particular discipline. It cuts across literature, travel books, journalistic writings, political commentaries. In fact, it pervades all discourse related to generation of ideas. The idea of the Orient is hegemonic in nature and is largely believed by the Western elite, politicians, and the policymakers. It provides a convenient policy framework in dealing with the East. In this power structure, the balance of power is tilted disproportionately in favor of the West. Colonial exploits of the 16th and 17th century England can be understood in the light. The disorganized and incompetent East cannot manage to imbibe civilizing influences and needs intervention, support, and guidance. Even today, the West communes with the East condescendingly. I have noticed that the BBC runs a daily program called Focus on Africa, which may be viewed as an effort to understand, sympathize, and help, but it may also be construed as undue focus on the poverty and helplessness of the African people, perpetuating a stereotypical representation of a whole population steeped in misery and poverty, which needs to be saved by the West. The West views Islam with suspicion and dismisses it as a pale replica of Christianity. Said stated in an article, Islam Through Western Eyes, published in 1980 in The Nation, I quote, "So far as the United States seem to be concerned, it's only a slight overstatement to say that Muslims and Arabs are essentially seen as either oil suppliers or potential terrorists. Very little of the detail, the human density, the passion of Arab Muslim life has entered the awareness of even those whose profession is to report the Arab world. What we have instead is a series of crude, essentialized caricatures of the Islamic world presented in such a way as to make that world vulnerable to military aggression, unquote. In his introduction to Orientalism, Said observes, quote, "I doubt if it is controversial, for example, to say that an Englishman in India or Egypt in the later 19th century took an interest in those countries which was never far from their status. In his mind, as British colonies. To say this may seem quite different from saying that all academic knowledge about India and Egypt is somehow tinged and impressed with, violated by the gross political fact. And yet, that's what I'm saying in this study of Orientalism," unquote. Although the roots of Western perception of the East are too deep to wither away completely anytime soon, more so as the East keeps sliding frequently into chaos and irrationality of its own making, yet signs of change cannot be missed. A number of Asian countries may still show signs of anarchy, superstition, illiteracy, and despotism, but the West too offers glimpses of its anarchic state of affairs from time to time. Gun violence in the United States, the conduct of many Westerners in their approach to lockdowns and restrictions, the Yellow Vest protest in France over many weeks in recent past, which turned violent on many occasions, can by no stretch of imagination be called signs of high civilizational values. Most of the advanced countries have taken big strides, riding on the brilliance and hard work of many intellectuals, thinkers, medical professionals, engineers, and corporate leaders who have had their roots in Asian and African countries. Said himself, a shining star in the Western literary pantheon, was born in Jerusalem to Hilda Said and Whitey Said. British Prime Minister Boris Johnson, who was briefing press on a daily basis prior to contracting coronavirus infection, had to abruptly leave the command of the government to two Indian origin politicians, Chancellor of the Exchequer Rishi Sunak and Secretary of State Priti Patel, who steered the nation quite admirably for more than 3 weeks. Although this is not factually correct statement, because the first Secretary of State, Dominic Raab, was deputized to steer the country, but in all practical purposes, for all practical purposes, these two are the people who were commanding the country, who were steering the country. In dealing with the pandemic, many Asian countries such as Taiwan, South Korea, Singapore, and India fared better than the US and almost the whole of Europe. Although the number of cases had risen in recent days in India, yet the mortality rate is quite low at 3.1%. as compared to France's 19.5%. And quite curiously, a country in the Middle East, Saudi Arabia, had the lowest rate of fatality at 0.5% among this club of high burden countries. Moreover, given the size and density of the population, complex social setup, rampant poverty, and many other negatives, the response and outcome could not have been better in case of India. The hospitals are standing tall and yet to be overwhelmed by sick patients. India's response to COVID has been hailed by the WHO and many Western nations. In the wake of the pandemic, the United States is keen to offer more visas to Indian medical professionals. A team of doctors in Bangladesh has recently claimed that a combination of drugs has shown remarkable results in treating the infected patients. An Indian lab, Serum Institute of India, is collaborating with Oxford University in their common pursuit of developing a vaccine for COVID-19. A professor of a prestigious law university, Sudhir Krishnaswamy, has been appointed by Facebook on an independent content oversight board that can overrule even Zuckerberg's decisions. Most spelling competitions are won by Asian Americans. Sundar Pichai, Satya Nadella, and numerous other business leaders are too familiar to be highlighted. Chinese technological, military, and engineering marvels are so spectacular that no one can call its people the sick men of Asia, though the phrase has come to haunt them again in view of the origin of the virus in Wuhan. Huawei, a Chinese company, has almost become a nightmare for the West, as no one can ignore its status as world leader in providing affordable and most advanced communication technology and equipment to the world. What I'm trying to suggest is the fact that the rapid rise of many Asian and African countries has the potential to force West reconsider its position with regard to the East. Instances of racial profiling and hidden undercurrents ranging from dislike to disgust have not disappeared completely. But I believe that the moment of reckoning is fast approaching, because it is impossible for the West to overlook the fundamental changes the East has undergone over the last few decades. Despite some contradictions and irritants still persisting, better dispersal of information, rise in the number of people who can think beyond boundaries, the real progress palpably present on the ground may herald the beginning of the end of Orientalism's life cycle. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It was definitely an engaging presentation. And I hope we are able to break the notion of the West that we have frozen in our civilization. We are no longer civilized, and we are able to break that. And I hope the Europeans are able to come out of their self-obsessed nature if they don't racially discriminate us. And post COVID-19, we emerge a better world. So I think we have still have, if I could have my Manjuja Edgar there.
Yes,
ma'am. Yes. We still have 20 minutes.
Yeah, some questions have come in.
There are five questions. Shall I read them, or would
yes,
you like
please.
To?
Yes, please. Yeah. Why don't you?
We could just start with that.
Yeah.
We have now it makes it six. So I could begin with the very first question. I would go question wise. And the first question is for Bhavna, the first speaker. It is from Nilag Dutta. Can you please talk about how various stages of feminisms tend to coexist at the same time today? For instance, could the advocacy of women's literacy by Malala be considered classical feminist or post-feminist or a mix of both? It is for Bhavna, but I think it's open to the panel. It's open to the panel.
All right. So if the chair permits, I would like to try and attempt to answer this.
Yes.
And then...
Yes.
All right. So first of all, I personally have always been very wary of creating these very rigid boundaries between when feminism comes in and which feminism comes in and comes out, etc. I think that which kind of feminism would be applicable is a very contextual question, and we have to be aware of where is the query coming from in a spatial temporal context. So for example, and if I may use that example, I think new media, and we are assaulted with an overt amount of new media these days. So you have platforms like Amazon Prime, and on one hand you have a show called Four More Shots of Vodka, where you have four women sitting on a beach and shouting vagina as if this is going to liberate you from all your feminist queries, for one. And you also have another show called Panchayat, where you have a woman who is the pradhan but never goes to office because it's the husband's job to go to office. So we do have that. And even in new media at the moment, what we are consuming through media is exposing us to this dichotomy, which was raised first in 1929 and has been revisited again and again and again. So yes, they all do occur at the same time. And we have to be aware about the context from which we are pulling these out, right? As to Malala Yousafzai, I'd like to take a different angle. I mean, it's not just a feminist question. It's also a question of survival. I mean, hers is a quest for survival. So when in the Nobel Peace Prize acceptance speech, when she says that I am not telling my story because it's unique, I am telling it because it's not. it tells us that there would always be different modalities of emancipation available to women all around the world. And it's for us to sit, decide, and work towards the one which works the best for, depending upon the subjectivity of the individual in question. I hope that answers.
Yeah. Thank you. Anyone else? Would you like any other panelists? Would you like to respond to it, or shall I go to the next question, please? Okay. I move to the next one. It's again from Nilak Datta, and it's for Mr. Anu. Does your project see desire as a historical or political? How does desire, consumer, become disruptive of the notion of a political identity? Anu, anybody else?
Yes.
Yes.
Desire is the motive force of a narrative. And if you talk about history, history is what but a narrative. And close reading or methodologies of reading, where desire plays a significant role, is, you know, a way in which we sort of get plural and multiple understandings of particular text. I would say that it's the behavior of reading a text. And if I, you know, sort of bring in Freud here, because Freud sort of talks about the drives, whether it's the eros, that is the life-affirming force, or the death instinct, or other concepts like repetition, which is basically a mode of, remembering something, speaking out loud to somebody, to oneself, because one has repressed certain things. Or transference, for that matter. All of these are also the way in which we as readers behave when we are reading. So reading is a very, very bodily experience. So therefore, history also can be read bodily. And therefore, that disrupts certain very, very objective ways in which we sort of understand history as in a linear, diachronic, taxonomized version of history, you know. So desire sort of is disruptive. It's a force that sort of intervenes into these very, very, systematized ways of reading. And the second point, second question was basically on. Could you repeat the second part of the question?
If yes, please. It is, how does desire, within brackets, consumer, become disruptive of the notion of a political identity?
Okay. So the consumer is basically consuming desire in the sense that the consumer is basically in a set of relationships where there is a desire to fulfill the immediacy of it. So we see that whether it is, you know, the way in which Valentine's Day is celebrated in Archie's shops or, in restaurants, or Women's Day is celebrated through, you know, different kinds of offers that Amazon sort of advertises, or, you know, the kind of perks, etc., whatever, you know, that restaurants offer or anything. I mean, the kind of commercialization of desire, because desire is also very political. Desire is also a reminder that we are always intersecting with other identities and other ways of experiencing lives and realities. So when this becomes a commercial product to sell, and when this actually brings about, you know, the consumer, the idea of a consumer will purchase it, then the entire relationship between desire sort of reduces to a relationship between the buyer and the seller. So that sort of reduces the political import of desire and makes it into an object.
Thank you, Anu. May I allow you to proceed to the next question? It is from Disha. She says, thank you, Smita. Smita, you could unmute yourself, please. Yeah. thank you, Smita, for your reflections on how the class responds to the text they have to read and might not necessarily be interested in. Do you see students' indifference persist through the course, or is there a shift in their perceptions where they are able to watch popular media and appreciate literary texts at the same time?
Actually, that's a very good question, because I had a lot of examples in my paper from popular culture where there is an immense amount of, like, if anyone has seen, I mean, now that we've had so many shows being mentioned, there is a show called The Good Doctor, which is on Prime right now. And it actually showcases an episode where a very senior surgeon actually undermines his intern's place in his team, and she's a woman. And the way the nurses and everyone just, they need to, kind of reiterate the fact that women have found a space in zones where they were not originally intended to be was terrific, actually, to see in a visual medium. I was going to talk about it, but then again I ran out of time. These are the kinds of examples with which we can rope in the interest of our students immediately. Italian job where there's a man saying don't kid yourself. All of us are emotionally involved in this, so we can engage a student this way, and it is very, very, that's a very fast, quick medium to capture their attention. But to retain it, that's where the game really becomes very, very tricky to play. I think, I don't know, 10 classes down the line, you're wondering what else there is to engage them. So perhaps that's where we need to do a lot of, work and input. But yes, absolutely, media of today can be used to engage a student in a classroom. That's all.
You think, Smita, they over a period after you have taught them for a while, do they really get interested in the text? Do they?
It happens, but you have to really push. I mean, it's like every day you wake up in the morning and say, I'm going to shove them towards this. I mean, it begins from Shakespeare. It's not like we start with Virginia Woolf. So from Shakespeare, we're shoving them and saying, you have to get interested in this. And it is. With each text, it's a journey, you know. With Virginia Woolf, it's a whole different game.
I think, thank you so much, Smita. We could go for the next question. That's for Anum. It's from Shruti. Your presentation brought forth a very relevant point. My question is, while #MeToo movement has somehow given space and courage to a particular section of society, however, the plight of those belonging to the margins with the plight of women remains nearly hushed and more or less the same. What kind of an effort, in your opinion, would it take to really bring about a change, particularly with reference to those untouched? Anu or anybody else?
Yes. Am I audible now?
Yes.
Thank you for your question, Shruti. I think I didn't have the time. We didn't have the luxury of time. But one of the main critics of the Me Too movement is that it is, limited to, one class or one section of society. And I believe that it's the Swarna-led feminists that have, taken that, they have become the flag bearers of Me Too movement. But having said that, it belongs to, a very educated and liberal, section of society, I also believe that some dialogue is better than no dialogue at all. It is important. See, everyone's story is important. Everyone's experience is important and we must also understand that when these movements arrive in India, just like the feminist movement that arrived in India, it undergoes a change because our society is very differently fabricated from the Western society, and one of the main aspects is the caste system and the whole marriage institution, that these things are different from the West. So when we can't imitate the movement that were originated or started from the West. We need to adapt them. And while talking about the Dalit women and their oppression, as I will give you an example that as a Muslim urban women okay, woman, my experience is very different from the help that comes to my house. But we share the same religious identity. So what we need to do is that we need to bring their stories forward. We need to educate them. And what, Wolf has said, it comes, you know, again, that we need to, you know, financially independent them, you know, they should be financially independent, that they should, you know, be overcome with their issues. Yes, I hope I answered your question.
Dilima.
Yes.
Dilima, I would like to add a point to it, yes, what Anu has just stated.
Yes, please.
I think, remember here, the text of Gayatri Spivak, can the subaltern speak?
Speak, yes.
Again, a seminal text.
Yes, I mean, seminal text, because if the subaltern is not in a position to talk, at least the people who are privileged, who have the voice, who have the right kind of language, who are able to articulate, they must speak on their behalf. So similarly, in the context of Me Too movement, if it is the urban classes who are able to initiate this movement and run this movement and getting so many people in prison, and if there are certain women who are not in a position to articulate their voices, somebody else must speak on their behalf.
Correct.
Thank you.
Correct. Yes. Ma'am Jetka, ma'am, there are three more questions. Two are general and one is specific. Should I take all three? We still have 10 minutes.
Yes. Quick questions and quick answers, please.
Yes, please. Yes, please. First, I'll just throw it to Gopika. How much of a role does Medium play when it comes to providing women with opportunities of self-passioning, where one can edit, add filters, be candid, perform, subvert, yet create their own brand of beauty and empowerment all at the same time? You could have a quick response and then I'll open two questions to all the panelists, please. Thank you.
Yeah, so it does give them plenty of opportunities, in fact. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, you are, please, quick.
Yeah, so it does give them plenty of opportunities. They can do whatever they want with their, as long as they have a mobile phone and internet connection and their data. So it's not a big deal. So people can do whatever they want with this kind of a thing. So, and these platforms offer a huge role, in fact. I mean, I can't really say, like, you know, the exact amount or something like that. I can't quantify it, but I can just, in terms of, like, use adjectives and say, it provides them many opportunities for that.
Thank you. I'll open the two questions to all the panelists. One is from, I think, maybe Professor Meenakshi. How do the ideas of post-feminisms and being an economic subject relate to the migrant women walking hundreds of miles towards their native homes?
Perhaps Anup could answer this. Anup, would you like to answer this?
Ma'am, I'll take the second one also, and there could be a mix and match.
Could you repeat the question?
Okay, I'll do it again. How do the ideas of post-feminisms and being an economic subject relate to the migrant women walking hundreds of miles toward their native homes?
I believe that feminism has really become so theoretical and academic that we spend hours and hours in our classrooms discussing about feminism, but then right out there on the ground, our own boys, our maids, I mean, what's going on in their lives? You know, are we really helping them enough in these very, very trying times? And I think that we are also, you know, at a point in history where we must see that women are of multiple types. It's not just about women who are biologically women or socially, culturally, how we perceive them to be women, but there was a lot of trans women and non-binary genders, and also, you know, the members of the sexual minority group. And they are equally, the hijras are equally disempowered and they equally need help. And all of these have to be institutionalized in the way we teach and we make our students aware, but at the same time also have to be, you know, in a sense, practicalized through, you know, different interventions that we can do. Probably, you know, not expecting so much from the government, of course we have to, but also sort of organizing, coming together, you know, having these self-help groups and just, you know, coming forward to bring about some kind of a change.
I think the point was made a little while ago that those who are privileged should make an effort to for the upliftment of those who are not so privileged. Huh? Somebody just made this point a little while ago.
I think we need to go from discourse to the event, from saying to happening. And may I just put the very last question to all the panelists? It is from Ahmed Azanuzum. I think the same person who was the panelist or was chairing the session two days back.
Yes.
What do you think about the future of the digital space being used by women oblique activists in the post-pandemic world? How do you see the digital world?
A very tall question which requires a very long answer.
Almost near to what Professor Praveen was trying to say.
That's right. But perhaps Praveen Kumar would like to answer one little question that I have. Do you think Edward Said is obsolete now?
Because
the world has moved on and so many things have changed and
This is the point I wanted to bring it to everybody's notice, that things are changing so quickly these days, and we can't exactly recall the same East that used to be there. So obviously it's true that Edward Said to some extent becomes obsolete.
And, but at the same East, and is his notion of East is very different from our notion of East, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am. That's true, but still there are certain countries where the situation is almost similar to what Said has pointed out, and things have not improved in certain countries. But obviously, there are lots of countries where things have undergone so much of change that we cannot identify the East mentioned by Edward Said with the East that we witness today.
Nilima, I think Lata might have something to say. Lata?
Yes, please.
Hello, everyone. So I have a question. So before that, I would just like to add some, you know, my views on women position. So what I feel is like the position of a woman in this world or India specifically, like, has been judged by being good sisters, being good mothers, and being good wives. And especially when it comes to the foundation of a family and a matrimonial framework. So the disparity here is not only between men and women. The disparity here also in between good woman and a woman, a good woman, a wife who obeys, who obeys her husband, and a good daughter who, good mother who takes care of children, and another woman who has nothing to do with the world and who is not ready to, follow the set rules made by the society. So this is, what my grapple has been with the society. And one is not born a woman, rather becomes one and still valid. So I will come to the question. My question is to Bhavana, right? So my question is, I'm interested in your thoughts on how women are portrayed on TV and in movies. And what do you think is the best example of a well-written female character in TV and in movies you have seen in past few years?
All right, again, a very difficult question to answer. But yesterday, I think there was a paper on film adaptation of Virginia Woolf. And it was talking about a double binary adaptation that has happened with The Hours, which was first textually adapted by Michael Cunningham and then put into filmic mode by Stephen Daldry. And I think the entire way in which Woolf is portrayed there, it's a brilliant, brilliant portrayal, because not just Woolf herself as a writer, as we know her, but also Woolf as a person, her neuroticism, and écriture, or the act of writing or feminine writing itself, becomes a character into that film. When you see a character like Clarissa Dalloway being played by Meryl Streep, and there is a three level of portraiture of how Woolf is portrayed, how Woolf's character is portrayed, and how that very elusive character of Laura Brown is portrayed. So I've been very smitten, would not be a good word, but I think that's the word I would like to go for with Stephen Daldry's projections. And then there's another TV show by HBO. It's called The Young Adult, that talks about, it's a faulty premise that if women can write, they can be empowered, because writing is not easy. Research is not an easy work. We struggle through it. We labor through it. And at the end of it, the brilliance is always questioned, or whether it can be called a brilliance or genius or not, or where you have simply looked into 100 different articles and put together a cherry-picked version of all of that. So again, I found that to be an interesting portraiture of how writing itself becomes a character within these narrativizations or their formulas.
Somebody from the audience wants to ask a question.
Yes.
Kamayani, what is the question that you have?
Yes, ma'am. Good evening. I have one observation to make to what Smita Varghese spoke about, her students not being very excited about feminism. Mm-hmm. I have a young son who studies in Ashoka and he's in the first year.
Kamaini?
Okay.
We lost you, Kamaini.
She's coming back. Kamaini?
Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yes, where are you?
Okay.
Yes, Kamaini.
All right. So I was wondering if that lack of interest in feminism is exactly the same as the lack of interest in the freedom movement is with this generation. So they haven't really been very close to the struggle itself, and they haven't seen the struggle firsthand. They're two generations removed from that. So the benefits of the struggle, the feminist struggle has, these benefits have already come to them with the generation. And therefore, they don't really understand why feminism as a theoretical struggle must constitute their current curriculum. At the same time, they understand very well.
Kamaini, your question?
Okay. Forget it. Uh-uh. I think just forget it, ma'am. I think I'm losing the signal. Forget it.
No, we can hear you very well.
We can hear you.
Okay. Please. Okay. So I feel that this is a generation that is twice removed from the original struggles of the women who actually began the feminist struggle, and therefore they don't relate to immediate concerns of what we call feminism. On another plane, they're already very feminist inherently. So my son continues to blame me for not being feminist enough. He blames me and my mom for not being feminist enough. So I'm not sure if they're not interested in feminism as an area of study, because they don't really feel the need for it right now as a theory, as theory. And secondly, about this Me Too movement, I read a whole article about the fallout of the Me Too movement. A result of this movement was that most of the organizations and the companies are now hesitant to recruit women. And I wonder if this is a positive result of this Me Too movement. So the struggles of women against patriarchy continue in a similar mode, and the subjugation of this struggle and the subjugation of these concerns becomes much more subtle and stronger, but they remain the same. So the struggles remain the same, the shade may become different, the color may become different, and the suppression of the struggle continues to be the same. So if women are now going to lose on this employment front because men are scared of the Me Too movement becoming a problem for them later on, I wonder how far we have really gained from this Me Too movement.
Anybody would like to respond from here?
Well, I think it was more of a comment, observation, yes, than a question. So yes, we could really move on to something else. If there's no more question, Nilima, maybe you'd like to wrap it up.
Should I wind up this session, ma'am?
We have exceeded the time. Yeah.
Just very briefly, thank you so much, all the panelists. I'm so glad that they were so rooted in what they were speaking, and they spoke with so much of feel. We have a bright future for academia, and there was a lot of involvement, and thankfully, and throughout these 5 days, the webinar has been absolutely serious, and there has been no, which used to happen in some of the seminars, the big melas, which didn't happen. And I'm so, I feel so pleasured and so privileged to be here. And thank you so much, ma'am. And thank you again to Purnima, because she actually, you both shook me out of my self-will, self-imposed quarantine complacency, if I may say so. Thank you so much for the technical session, one of the last, and I hope to see you all, not in the virtual space, otherwise too. And I would definitely like to say one thing, there is nothing wrong in being a feminist, and I don't mind being called a feminist.
Nothing wrong in, louder please.
Yeah, nothing wrong in being a feminist.
Oh yes.
I don't mind being calling myself a feminist. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you, Neelima, and I'd like to thank all the panelists. And I just have one announcement to make before we wind up. As I mentioned the other day, we are going to have one more session tomorrow, which will be a sort of a valedictory. It will be a virtual valedictory. And I request all the participants, all the delegates, all the speakers to come back to the session. But please note the time. We do not have the 2 o'clock slot because that's not available to us. There are lots of other webinars going on. The time that is given to us is 9:30. So please make it a point to come into the Zoom room a few minutes before 9:30 so that we can all say one last line to each other before we say au revoir. With that, thank you very much. It's been a great evening. Purnima, you want to say anything else? Lata, you want to say anything else?
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you all the presenters, and especially Neelima, ma'am, for gracing the session. Thank you, Emily, ma'am.
Thank you.
Smita, and Jareen Kumar, and Pripa, Bhavna, Anup.
Thank you very much.
The biggest thank you.
Thank you so much. Love you. Thank you.
See you again tomorrow at 9:30. Yeah. At 9:30. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Thank you, Smita.
Bye. Yeah. Thank you. Bye.